As Wonder Woman fans across the globe rejoice that the film is already shaping up to be a major hit, you can bet that in Tinseltown, many are already huddled with their agents and managers, feverishly asking, no, demanding, get me in Wonder Woman 2. Because who wouldn't want to be part of an emerging franchise that is apparently not just a fan and critic favorite, but is changing how women are depicted in Hollywood? This is something that Jessica Chastain was just complaining about at Cannes. But while she complained, Patty Jenkins and Gal Gadot actually did something about it. And I'm sure Jessica Chastain wants in. And that right there, casting, is Warner Brothers and Patty Jenkins' first real test to prove that they didn't just get lucky here. What am I talking about? Well, let's just say a lot of people are going to want into Wonder Woman 2, the sequel, who shouldn't be there, who are going to bring the film down to the level to which they have sunk. I'm talking about Reese Witherspoon. Sure, she's an Oscar winner, but right now she's just too TV. Big Little Lies was all about Nicole Kidman, and she's already an Aquaman. And then also, as for Jessica Chastain, she represents Hollywood's old combative feminism. I mean, this is someone who, with a straight face, argued that she should be paid the same amount of money for The Martian as Matt Damon, who was the star of the movie versus the handful of scenes that she appeared in. So we not only want to avoid their stink, but we also want to protect the tone of Wonder Woman, which is obviously so incredibly successful. The film not only has a classic tone, but it manages to avoid seeming like a chick flick or a TV movie, which, make no mistake, is a real danger when you have a female-led film. That's just the reality of it. There, you know, been chick flicks have been conditioning how people view female-led films for quite some time, and TV has been a very prolific space for women as of late, so that's why it could sometimes maybe veer in that direction. Now, I know many of you are saying, that's not women's fault, that's just where the roles materialized, and that's true, and you're going to see a lot of female TV talent on my casting shortlists here. But in each case, Warner Brothers and Patty Jenkins have to ask themselves, honestly, if they can elevate said female TV talent to seem like they're worthy of the big screen. Now, I'm not talking about their acting ability. That's apparent, or they wouldn't be on my casting shortlist. I'm talking about making it seem like they didn't just walk from the small screen to the big screen, to changing the way they look, doing something exciting that makes them, again, seem cinematic. So who should Warner Brothers and Patty Jenkins say yes to? Here are my ideas, my casting ideas for Wonder Woman's top villains. And I made this my first Wonder Woman 2 video because for the most part it's spoiler free, except for the last villain. But don't worry, I will give you a warning when we head into spoiler territory. And even there, it's not too spoilery. If you've been really paying close attention to Wonder Woman, you'll still be all good. But right off the bat, I want to tell you that there are two villains you're not going to find here, and that's Dr. Psycho and Maxwell Lord, because of a little Netflix show called Jessica Jones, which I think was revolutionary in its own right, perhaps even in some ways a stepping stone for what's been accomplished here with Wonder Woman. But if she, of course, is another raven-haired heroine who went up against a guy with mind control powers. So we don't want to have a repeat of that, because not only have we already seen it done so well, but again, we don't want to seem like we're heading into TV territory. And also, Supes already did the neck snap, so we don't need Maxwell Lord even more so. Now, also I want to point out, some of you might say, well, some of these villains, you know, I have to say, Wonder Woman has a little bit of a supporting characters rogues gallery problem. You know, they're not particularly well known. And I think that's been for a reason. They're very antiquated, because of course, you're talking about someone who comes from Greek mythology, right? And I think, for the most part, hasn't had a lot of characters invented in the last couple of decades, right? So they're literally old villains. But I'd like to point out that Greg Rucka, on his current Rebirth run, which is coming to a close, sadly, but definitely check it out, has done a fabulous job modernizing Wonder Woman's villains, almost as if that was part of his to-do list with taking over the Rebirth title, well, debuting it. He debuted it. And he just did such a fabulous job bringing these characters into current day, in not only a way that's believable, but that's exciting. And we're definitely going to discuss it when we discuss the villains individually. And I hope that Patty Jenkins is aware of this run. She must be. I mean, Jeff Johns is working very closely with her, and I'm sure he's like, have you read this? It's amazing. But I say this because they were recently talking to Gal Gadot about a sequel, and they said, well, what do you think would take place in the sequel, or more importantly, perhaps, where? Because this is a World War I adventure, the first movie. And she said, I don't know, Wonder Woman is 5,000 years old. And I'm like, no, no more time travel. We had a nice little time when you emerged to man's world during World War I. Let's go to the current time. Because largely there's a reason that we need to be in current time that stems directly from the first film, but I can't discuss it here because I promised you mostly no spoilers. But that's a big part why you're going to see me pushing so hard for modern versions of these villains. All right, so now that I've explained it, let's get to the one that Greg Rucka did the best job modernizing, and that's Circe. That's right, the one from Homer's Odyssey. She's turned into a Wonder Woman villain who's basically an evil sorceress, think female Loki, but more spells, less plotting, which I think would be a welcome change of pace because we already have Loki, right? And also this would keep this from seeming too TV-like because you'd have a very high visual effects budget for all her spells. That would be very exciting indeed. But Greg Rucka and his artist reimagined Circe not only as Soho artist chic, but gender neutral, which I thought was fascinating and very current. A lot of people have been talking about, you know, Wonder Woman has been a role model not just for women, but for the LGBT community as well. So to see that reflected perhaps in a very exciting, I mean, I know she would be a villain, but a very dynamic, exciting villain, I think could go a long way. And so my first recommendation is Asia Kate Dillon, aka Taylor from Billions. And if you watched Billions season two, you're already on board with this idea. Asia Kate Dillon did a phenomenal job, so much so that almost as soon as her first episode aired, there has been Emmy talk. And what's interesting is that Wonder Woman, of course, is all about emotion, but Asia Kate Dillon excels at playing a cold, calculating witch. Wouldn't that be a fascinating contrast? But if you don't want to go with Asia Kate Dillon, I have to suggest Lena Headey. Now, sure, she already plays somebody named Circe on Game of Thrones, but she does it so well and would do such a fabulous job in a Wonder Woman movie. And I think Game of Thrones is already quite cinematic that this could be maybe too good to pass up, even if there are obvious similarities and overlaps. But if you want to go with somebody else, how about Julianne Moore, a bona fide silver screen actress, and this would take her back to the early days of her career when she was working with the likes of Robert Altman, the Coen brothers, and I think actually doing some of her best work. The only problem here, though, is that it might be too similar to her upcoming role in Kingsman 2, where she plays the villain there. I think she could change it up and make it work, and she looks so much like Greg Rucka. Imagine, that's one of the reasons I particularly like casting her, but I can see it maybe being a no-go. So then how about Taraji P. Henson? It's not, I think, what she had in mind when she recently pitched hardcore to be put in a superhero movie, but I think that once she sees the role and realizes what she can do with it, like she did on Empire with Cookie, she might get a little bit more excited. All right, so that's our first villain, Circe. Next up is Veronica Cale, who is the head of Cale Anderson Pharmaceuticals, and I'm sure many of you are like, oh, I get this. Female Lex Luthor, right? No. Feminist Lex Luthor. Why the qualifier? Well, a big part of why Veronica Cale hates Wonder Woman is that she feels Wonder Woman makes it look too easy. That if you're not an Amazonian goddess, it is a lot harder to break through the glass ceiling. And so there is not only that element at play, but I think it's a take on women hating women, other women. And I think that would be really fascinating for a Wonder Woman movie to deal with. I know some of you are like, not more feminism, but I'm sorry, that's the character. I think Patty Jenkins and Gal Gadot and the wonderful group of male screenwriters that they worked with have proven that they can handle this quite tactfully. And I think do a better job explaining it than anyone has ever done before in the history of feminism. So who would I cast here? Well, I like the idea of Elizabeth Moss, who's really hot right now off of Hulu's Handmaid's Tale. But also, of course, she was on Mad Men, where her character wanted to be Don Draper. So here's her chance to do so. Also, Charlize Theron, of course, is the dream choice for this role. But would she really play another villain after her turn in two Huntsman movies, the second of which did not go particularly well? And then also, she wouldn't be the lead. But what's keeping hope alive here? Well, she knows Patty Jenkins, who won her an Oscar with Monster, so maybe it's time for Patty Jenkins to call in that favor. You owe me, Charlize Theron, play Veronica Cale. And she could really maybe do something quite interesting with it. But here's another interesting casting choice. So many TV actors, because again, this is an exciting place for female talent right now. But it's going to be tricky. It's going to be tricky, Patty Jenkins. Be careful. But I recommend Kirsten Dunst from Fargo Season 2, where she knocked it out of the park. A fabulous, career-redefining performance. She can clearly play a charismatic villain. Also, she's currently in Beguiled, which Sofia Coppola just won, I think the second time, I believe the second time ever a woman has won Best Director at the Cannes Film Festival. So she has some cinematic momentum behind her as well. She's not too TV. Then, of course, there's Cheetah, who perhaps is Wonder Woman's best-known villain these days. And since the first Wonder Woman movie already has a strong Indiana Jones vibe, why not introduce Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva, cursed enchantress style, on her own exposition? Well, whoever does insurance for expositions is like, I'm going to go out of business with all these super heroics going on, or super villainy going on. But what I also like about this is that Wonder Woman works in a museum, as is established in the Wonder Woman movie. And that's not a spoiler, because you've already seen it in the Justice League trailer. But that would be a great way to have her and Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva first meet. Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva goes out and collects these artifacts, and Diana cleans them up and puts them on display. I think that would be fabulous. And that would maybe be the beginning of their friendship, which is an important part of the Cheetah storyline. I bet you know about Cheetah, but you don't know that much about her. Again, pick up Greg Rucka's Rebirth run. But her curse that turns her into the Cheetah is a genuine curse, so it's a good acting opportunity for actresses out there. You know, it might just at first glance, Cheetah, so much more going on here. You might be like, I just have to wear a bunch of cat makeup. No, there's a lot to play with. And I would actually have her be able to change in and out of her Cheetah state to make it more attractive a role for an actress. So I would really target Emily Blunt for this. I think it's looking less and less likely at this point she's going to get a female superhero lead, so why not go for a iconic villain? But then if she doesn't want to do it, Priyanka Chopra I would recommend, who's currently on Baywatch, where I have to say her acting wasn't that great, but it has proven that she has a very strong fan base, originating in India, but getting bigger by the day. So I would be interested in bringing her in. Also, the first Wonder Woman movie has quite the global feel to it, so I think that should be reflected in the casting. I have some more international choices for our final villain. And then also here, though, I want to recommend Sarah Paulson, who did an amazing job playing Marcia Clark on The People vs. O.J. Simpson. She took a role that seemed so unsympathetic and made you do a 180 on how you saw that real life person. I mean, it was an amazing tour de force performance. And she's shown in the past a willingness to go there when it comes to prosthetics and makeup with her work on American Horror Story. And she's already in Ocean's 8, so she's already getting into film. So again, there wouldn't be too much of a burden on Wonder Woman to make her seem cinematic. So I really think she would be fabulous. I'm torn on that one between Emily Blunt and Sarah Paulson. Now here's the final villain, spoiler territory. Again, slight spoiler territory. If you've been following Wonder Woman at all, and if you've heard about David Thewlis, you're good to go. But otherwise, you might want to bail out and come and revisit after you've seen the movie. Still here? All right, well, there is a surprising amount of death in Wonder Woman. That's all I'll say. So it's only natural that Hades, who rules the underworld, would be the next god to face our Amazon warrior. So how about James Woods? Just kidding. I had to do it though, because there is a very strong Disney princess vibe or Disney animated movie vibe to Patty Jenkins and Gal Gadot's Wonder Woman. And maybe they would maybe want to do a nod to that. I think that would be fun. But anyway, seriously, David Thewlis is playing Ares, as you've heard. Already was leaked months ago. And what's interesting about his performance is that it has a real strong Alec Guinness vibe to it. So on that note, why don't we go that way with all of our gods and have Mark Rylance for Hades, the ultimate Still Waters Run Deep character actor. I think he would be absolutely fabulous. But if you want to go in the more traditional sense of a Greek god, how about Jean Dujardin? France actually plays a surprisingly big part in the first Wonder Woman movie, which I thought was a wonderful surprise. So why not have that country represent with one of their most celebrated actors? And he's well known here. Well, actually, it's interesting. He won an Oscar, and then he couldn't get any follow-up roles. It's so horrible. He had to be sent home with his Oscar back to France. So we owe Jean Dujardin. We got him hooked on Cinnabon when he was here. He said he loved Turn on Red and Cinnabon. That's what he loved about America. And then we just dumped him. So let's bring him back and put him in Wonder Woman 2 as Hades. I think he would be fabulous. But if we don't want to go with Jean Dujardin, what about Shahab Hosseini, who is a popular and very highly regarded Iranian actor. I saw him for the first time in The Salesman last year, which was an Oscar contender. I believe it actually did win, I think. I'll correct myself up on the screen if I got it wrong. But when I was watching him in this film, I thought to myself, why is this man not working in Hollywood? He's fabulous. And he speaks very good English as well. Sometimes there's a language barrier, there's an accent barrier with Jean Dujardin, to be perfectly honest with you. That's one of the things that held him back. But Shahab Hosseini, I apologize if I'm mispronouncing his name, I think he's a fabulous actor and would add to, that global feel to the sequel. I think he would be a great choice. I would love to see him in the role. But then my final recommendation is Matthew Rhys from The Americans. And if you watch The Americans, you are also excited about this idea. He is one of the most criminally overlooked actors working today. And it's time for him to get his dues. Whenever anybody talks about The Americans, they're always talking about Kerry Russell, who they're actually, they're in a relationship. I don't know if they're married. They do have a child together. But Kerry Russell, of course, is already known to people from Felicity. So whenever anybody talks about The Americans, they're like, Kerry Russell, Felicity. But they never really talk about Matthew Rice, which is a shame. So, and he is also, by the way, a British actor. Fabulous accent work. Ah, you Brits and your accent work. It's amazing. So I think it would be wonderful to see him jump to the silver screen with Wonder Woman 2. And also what would be most interesting about it is that it would give Wonder Woman a charismatic adversary who was really almost a yin to Steve Trevor's yang. You know, with the coloring, there's like a similarity between the two actors, but also a difference. I think that could be really interesting to play with. About around the same age, I think that would just be fabulous. So those are my casting ideas for the Wonder Woman sequel. I'm curious, what are your thoughts on my ideas? What are your own ideas? And who else do you think would be a bad choice for Wonder Woman 2? Who should they keep away at all costs? Maybe you want to defend Reese Witherspoon and Jessica Chastain. You probably already did, but feel free to do so down below. And I have a whole bunch of Wonder Woman coverage this week. It's Wonder Woman week on Beyond the Trailer. There's a link to that coverage down below in the video description. And so here are some of those episodes for you to watch right now.